talking about the, if you like, motivation for topological quantum computing as distinct from quantum computing in general, which I'm sure that you're all very well aware of the motivations for quantum computing in general. So let's imagine that we are intending to set up a quantum computing protocol. It'll be the usual circuit model, nothing fancier than that. Then we can define an ideal quantum memory as a set of n qubits of some kind, which can store an arbitrary quantum superposition. And in general, of course, we're going to be interested in entangled superpositions. It can store it faithfully for an arbitrary time. That is, it can maintain both the amplitudes and the relative phases of these coefficients as long as we need to do it. And of course, that's something which is not merely useful in quantum computation. There are other aspects of quantum information, like communication, where it might also be useful to have this. And let's define an ideal quantum computer as an ideal quantum memory with an additional property, namely that we can perform on it arbitrary one-particle gates and on at least some pairs of qubits, at least one two-particle gate, for example, C naught, but it could be C phase or various other things. Now, of course, as you're all very well aware, the generic problem, or one of the generic problems which we run into when trying to construct a quantum computer, is decoherence. And crudely speaking, what that means is that if we are going to be able to manipulate the amplitudes and phases of the various states involved, then nature is almost going to certainly going to find a way to do it too. When nature does it in a way which we don't intend, of course, that's, crudely speaking, what we call decoherence. In other words, nature is going to find ways to change the amplitudes of the coefficients C in this expression. These are processes which in NMR language are called T1 processes, or in quantum information language, bit flips. Nature's also going to find ways to change the relative phases of these coefficients. In NMR language, that's T2 processes, and here's, I'm afraid there's a typo, this should, of course, be phase flips here. Incidentally, I apologise for the number of typos, which I'm going to have to comment on in this in the last two lectures and in this one. These are basically a result of the fact that these first three lectures had to be retyped from scratch. And retyping always tends to introduce certain errors. Hopefully in future, we'll be able to directly copy what we need to, and so there won't be, that then there'll only be the errors which are there in the original, which are no doubt also are non-zero, but hopefully not so many. Okay, so then we have to try to devise maneuvers which either nature can't imitate, or at least is not likely to imitate. And of course, there are some very well-known examples of this which don't involve any topological aspects. A typical example might be the use of trapped ions for quantum computing. The point about trapped ions is that effectively, the point is that we have lasers and nature doesn't. In other words, we can prepare our ions in such a way that if we don't take a hand in the affairs, then those ions are really pretty well isolated from their environment, and nature can't really do anything unpleasant to them. On the other hand, if we want to come in and change the state of the ion, then we focus in our laser and do so. And that's something very specific to the technology we have, and nature doesn't. So what we're going to try to do now is to devise maneuvers of this type which specifically depend on the topological characteristics of many body systems. So let me start by recapping an example which I already gave at the beginning of lecture one, but I think it is quite a useful example to think about. That is the the question of the metastability of finite circulation and therefore finite angular momentum states of superfluid helium 4 in an annular geometry. Experimentally, it's true that these circulating states, states of finite angular momentum, have lifetimes which is certainly much larger than the age of the universe, as long as we keep our system safely below the transition temperature, the lambda temperature. So why is this? Well, the naive answer, of course, is that this could be just due to conservation of angular momentum. But if you think about it, that really isn't very plausible. I mean, if you really had an ideally cylindrical container with no quantum vibrations or anything like that, maybe that would work. But in real life, of course, you don't. And the real reason why these states are so stable is a topological one, which I already went through briefly in the first lecture, but let's just do it again briefly. In the superfluid state, you have the so-called condensed fraction of your atoms, which are a finite fraction of the whole. They will condense into a single one-particle state, which has some kind of wave Schrodinger-like wave function, the condensate wave function. And when that wave function is independent of the angle around the annulus, then that means that the angular momentum is zero. We call that chi0 of R. If the wave function has a variation with angle which goes as exponential IL phi, then that means that that each atom has an angular momentum L h bar, and therefore the total angular momentum is n times L times h bar, where n is the condensate fraction, or the condensate number, rather. So then the crucial question is, is it possible for for chi L of R, that is this one here, with the phase winding, to relax into chi zero? And as we discussed earlier, provided that the amplitude of the wave function is everywhere non-zero, then the winding number, the integral of the gradient of the phase around the loop, or if you like, the number of turns made by the phase as we go around the loop, is conserved on topological grounds. Now, there's an interesting little point connected with that, which I think is not widely known, and therefore let me just take a moment to talk about this. We've used this argument for many, many years. It probably goes back to someone like Bloch in the 30s or 40s, I imagine. I'm not quite sure who actually first wrote it down quite explicitly. And therefore, there's been a temptation to assume that a superfluid of any kind, any kind of system which has undergone some kind of Bose condensation and therefore presumably is superfluid, and any system of this kind must show the same metastability. And it turns out probably the case, interestingly. Jason Ho, in a very interesting paper in the early 80s, pointed out the following. Suppose that my, what I've been discussing at this point is helium-4, which indeed is a simple system. We believe that we can describe the state of the condensate by a simple Schrodinger-like wave function. But suppose life is a little more complicated than that. Suppose that the system in question has a non-zero spin. So the example that Ho was actually thinking of was spin-polarized hydrogen, which we now know does indeed undergo Bose condensation and, as far as we know, is superfluid. However, that does have a spin degree of freedom. It's the nuclear degree of spin degree of freedom. So it's basically a spin-a-half Bose condensate. Now, the question is that system going to show this kind of metastability? Well, it depends, of course, as always, it depends exactly on how you phrase the question and what the constraints are. But at least generically, as it were, the answer is no, for the following reason. You remember that in lecture one, we examined how the phase of the wave function changes if I have a spin-a-half system and I create a Boojum-like or a willow-like texture. Remember how the phase changes as I go around the loop? It goes through 2 pi. Right? Now, imagine that I indeed have I've put my system of spin-a-half particles into a state of circulation of 2 pi, say with spin down. OK? okay? Then what I can do is to rotate my spins around the around an axis in the xy plane, which depends on where I am. In other words, crudely speaking, if I'm off in this direction, then I rotate around this angle. If I'm off here, I rotate around this angle, etc., etc. Okay. Now that is exactly the inverse of the willow pattern that I showed in lecture one. Right. So by doing that, I actually return to a state which has angular momentum zero, circulation zero, and spin up. So I've gone from in the lecture one, I went from spin up to spin down. Now I'm that process, as it were. And therefore, now you see the interesting point about that is that all I had to do was to change the direction of the spins. I didn't have to change the amplitude of the condensate wave function at all. And therefore, at least for the simplest kind of Hamiltonian, there's no energy cost in doing this. So the intriguing conclusion of this argument is that at least under these conditions, if I've got a simple Hamiltonian of this kind, so I'm allowed to basically vary the direction of my spins without energy cost. Then no circulating state of a spin a half post condensate is ever metastable. Very amusing conclusion, I think.
Can you repeat the distinction? What was the distinguishing feature about spin half as opposed to spin half?
Yeah. Crudely speaking, that there are various kinds of operation you can go through with spin a half, which have no analog in the spin zero case. Oh, sorry, you said spin a half and spin one.
Or both on.
No. Oh, okay. Okay. Sorry. That may be a little confusing. The distinction here is not really between bosons and fermions. We're always talking about bosons.
Right.
Now, how come? Okay, you might ask, how come that the bosons have spin a half? Right. fair question. The answer is that you're talking about something like spin-polarized hydrogen. Now, spin-polarized hydrogen, or hydrogen, remember, has an electron and a proton. If you put it in a sufficiently strong magnetic field, the electron spins are going to be totally polarized, but they're still there. So when I exchange two hydrogen atoms, I still have to take account of the fact that I have to put in a minus sign for the electron spins. What's left over are the nuclear spins. Now they have a small Z amount of energy, but it's sort of small compared to KT, etc. So we can forget about it. So the nuclear spin now constitutes a spin a half degree of freedom. Yeah.
Is it individual hydrogen atoms or
extreme molecules? No, they're individual atoms. Yep.
Ah,
okay. Good question. Yeah. Well, fine. I think. You know, I suspect this lecture wouldn't take the whole 1.5 hours anyway, so we can afford to take a little time off for this. Yeah. No. Okay. Well, this is a more generic question about ultra-cold atoms generally. Okay. We didn't even think about hydrogen. We can think about the original realization, which was rubidium-87. Okay. Now, you ask the question. I take 10^9 rubidium-87 atoms. And I confine them in a relatively small space. I actually do this by magnetic trap. Okay, what is their ground state? Well, trivially, the answer is solid rubidium. Right? So of course, the interesting question is now, okay, why don't they get there? And now this is something which is very interesting. I did some work on ultra-cold atoms of various kinds way back in the 80s and so forth, long before there were any experiments on it. And I never really took this work seriously because I thought, for goodness sake, these things are, these hypothetical monatomic states are going to simply collapse. And the answer, well, experimentally they don't. Over a period of a few minutes, so, which is, eternity by the standards of atomic physics. Why not? Well, you just think about the collision of two identical rubidium-87 atoms in free space. Just any number of conservation rules you have to satisfy, the most important of which, of course, are conservation of energy and momentum, but there's also parity and all sorts of other things. Turns out, when you put them together, those conservation rules are sufficiently strong that binary collisions are almost completely forbidden. They basically give you a lifetime of the order of the age of the universe. So the only collisions which you do have to worry about are three-body collisions. Now those, you see, depend on the square of the density. You've got to get your three atoms together. And in certain cases, incidentally, this doesn't actually apply to the hydrogen case, but it applies to some other interesting cases. In certain cases, it turns out that even if you've got three bodies, it's still very difficult for them to combine. That would be the case, for example, if you had real fermions, you see, as you do in some cases. To have a three-body collision, you've got to get three of those fermions sitting close together. But since because of the Pauli principle, this is essentially forbidden. But even apart from that, even in the case of bosons, you get these incredibly long lifetimes by standard atomic physics measure. So, if it weren't for that, then of course there would not be a field of cold atom physics.
Are you saying that meridian crystals don't occur, or under what conditions?
Okay. Ed can fill us in more on this, but crudely speaking, what will tend to happen if you actually try in real life, if you try to confine rubidium 87 atoms in a small volume, there will be occasional three-body collisions, and generally speaking, because of the detailed nature of the traps and so forth, the effect of these is to eject some of the atoms concerned out of the trap. So you just basically lose them. Now, if that were not the case, if we imagine we could construct a trap such that this didn't happen, then I guess what you'd find is that you form some kind of excited state. Two of your three colliding atoms might form some kind of excited state of the diatomic molecule, and that would gradually cascade downwards. Again, that would have to involve collisions with third atoms, by and large. And so, at the end of the day, you get a whole lot of molecules, and if you let them sit there for long enough, presumably they're going to glob together to form a liquid and so on. So they'll get there, but they'll only get there over a very, very long time scale. Okay, so that was a bit of a digression, but nevertheless, interesting thing. So we basically, as long as we can ensure that for this spin zero case, as long as we can ensure that the magnitude of the condensate wave function stays non-zero, then we have our topological conservation law, and we can it is ensured in real life by this quartic term in the interaction energy. And under almost all experimentally realized conditions, this total interaction energy, which guarantees this, is huge compared to KT. If you're very close, there is an amusing point here. If you're very, very close to the Lambda temperature, and you try to do this kind of experiment, then you will find, it's predicted theoretically, that you will find a very, very slow decay of your metastable state. And indeed, a beautiful series of experiments by John Reppie and his co-workers in the late 70s, which actually demonstrated this. You have to be very, very close to the Lambda temperature for this to work. If you're not there, then essentially it's metastable on the lifetime of the universe or longer. Okay, so this is a case where many-body topological considerations have guaranteed us a certain degree of stability. Just imagine that we thought of using this system as a qubit. And perhaps not very plausible on all sorts of grounds, but let's just imagine it. In other words, we'd use as our basis states of our qubit the L equals 0 and L equals 1 states of superfluid helium-4 in an annulus. We want to use that as a basis of quantum memory. Then what we've shown by the argument we've given is that basically T1 is enormous, of the order of the lifetime of the universe, or greater. However, what about T2? Now, you have to remember, when you're talking about T2, then this is this concerns the evolution of the relative phase of your up and down states. In NMR language, that means that you are sensitive to any kind of energy difference between the up and down states, which is effectively any kind of external magnetic fields. Right? Now, So the analog of a magnetic field in NMR is going to be any effect which causes the relative energy of your two states to fluctuate. I think it's at least extremely plausible that just about any non-trivial coupling to the environment is going to affect those energies. For example, the current density, J of R, is going to interact at some level with fluctuations of the gravitational field. And I haven't put in the numbers, but since you're talking about a macroscopic system here, my strong guess is that the effective T2s, which you calculate, are probably going to be less than the order of seconds, probably much less than that, in fact. Now, as I say, that's not the only reason one wouldn't want to use this particular system as a cube, but I think it's a very killing one if you ever did. So the moral is then that even to achieve a good quantum memory, let alone a good quantum computer, what you need to do is to make sure that within the qubit space, all local operators are simply proportional to the unit matrix. If you can do that, then automatically the dephasing contribution to T2 will go to zero. Now, that's not quite enough by itself, because even if within this space all those operators are proportional to the unit operator, nevertheless, they may have matrix elements between this space and other excited states. So what you want to do is to have an energy gap between the ground state manifold and any excited states. And that then will ensure that higher order contributions to both T1, the inverse of T1 and the inverse of T2 are exponentially suppressed. A crude example of that was the helium-4 case. In the case of this doesn't work for T2, but in the case of T1, in order to get a transition between the states of different winding number, you had to depress the order parameter to zero. That cost a non-zero, and in fact very large, amount of energy. So intuitively, what we want to do is that we want to the different states of our qubit basis to differ in a very subtle kind of way, and to be connectable only by a very sophisticated process which must involve the surmounting of some kind of energy gap. In a way, and hopefully, we're going to be able to engineer that by a sufficiently clever technology. Nature, hopefully, will not be able to do that. And the occurrence of such states is really, I mean, you really don't get this situation, or at least I don't know of any case in which you get this situation in a simple one-particle systems. It's characteristic of many particle systems, and strictly speaking, we only achieve the ideal situation in the thermodynamic limit, n goes to infinity, though it will turn out that that experimentally accessible values of n are quite sufficient for our purposes, luckily. Now, it turns out, and this is not obvious, this is something I just have to tell you at the present stage, the possibility of both a topological quantum memory and topological quantum computation is associated with the presence in the system which we're going to use of anions. These anions are particles obeying fractional statistics, and I'll come to these towards the end of this lecture. Topological quantum memory requires at least a billion anions, whereas for quantum computation, you require further, not a billion anions. So in this lecture, I'm going to be mostly talking about a billion anions and related things, and then in subsequent lectures, I'll go on and talk about the non-abelian case. Okay, any some general questions before I go on to specific cases? Yeah, basically because let's suppose you've got some kind of perturbation, for example, in which the electric current of your system is coupling to random external magnetic fields or something of the kind. Perhaps a better example would be one in which your charge density, actually. Suppose your charge density distribution of your system is coupling to random electric fields, say. Okay, well, there will be some kind of strength of that interaction. If I can show that within the ground state manifold, the appropriate matrix elements are just the unit matrix, then there are no, as it were, this can't affect any direct transitions. However, I might still get an indirect transition via an excited state. Now, the matrix element between the ground state and the excited state is going to be some number, which is finite. The energy gap is going to be, the gap to the excited state is also going to be finite. Let's suppose that, and hopefully by appropriate engineering, I can ensure that the ratio of the matrix element to the excitation energy is small. I mean, it's not zero. So. Now, the crucial point is that because of the as it were, the many-body nature of the topological protection of these states, I'm going to have to actually make that transition, not once, but in times. Okay? So that means that this small parameter is going to be multiplied by, is going to be raised to the nth power. Yeah, I should have perhaps made that a little more explicit. Okay, any other questions before I go on? Now I'm going on to a couple of very specific examples of topological protection. And these will actually, it will turn out, these will involve a billion anions, so we're not yet at the non-abelian state. So my first example comes from a very beautiful paper, which I think is really a classic in this area, by Wen and New, way back in 1990. And it's the title of their paper is Fractional Quantum Hall Effect on Arcturus. And actually, I think that title is perhaps, if you like, slightly too specific. We'll see, actually, in some sense, the discussion is more general than what the title would imply. Let's consider an integral number, n sub e, spinless electrons on a plane, which are subject to periodic boundary conditions. In other words, it's as if we had bent the plane into a toroidal geometry. You apply a magnetic field, B, perpendicular to the plane in the standard way. Now, of course, you might object at this point that if I really have a square plate, then there's no particular reason why I should have periodic boundary conditions. Right? In order to ensure that I really do have periodic boundary conditions, I really do have to bend the thing into a physical torus. Right? Now, however, the condition that B everywhere be normal to the surface of the torus will probably violate Maxwell's equations. So this really isn't terribly realistic. However, it's a very nice problem from the conceptual point of view. We have our magnetic field directed perpendicular everywhere to the surface, and we'll define a magnetic length, H bar over EB to the half. And you notice, incidentally, that this, apart from the magnetic field itself, this only contains universal constants. It does not contain any of the materials parameters of your system. The area per flux quantum is 2 pi times lambda m squared, and therefore the number of flux quanta, n sub s, which I'm going to call that n sub s, that's given by this expression here. And I'm going to assume that n sub s is integral, as indeed Wen and New do, at least implicitly. Now, why? Well, the reason is that not that in real life it necessarily has to be integral, but that if it is not, then you can't actually define vector potentials and the things that you want to define on a torus, so in the toroidal geometry. And you see, in some sense, at this point one has to remember that we're talking about something which is not really a physical model. It is, an abstract toy model. And so we're entitled to impose this condition. Now, we'll mostly be interested in the case which, in fractional quantum Hall, in the language of the quantum Hall effect, would be called the condition for the fractional quantum Hall effect, namely that the number of electrons divided by divided by the number of flux quanta is rational fraction p over q, where p and q are mutually prime integers. And now we don't actually have to, interestingly, we don't have to specify at this point that Q is odd, although that is the condition which is normally fulfilled in the fractional quantum Hall effect. Incidentally, I will be talking in detail about the fractional quantum Hall effect in the next lecture. Yeah. No spins in this problem at all. These. Anywhere they want to be. Yep. And of course, we're in the thermodynamic limit, so that NE and NS are both large compared to 1. So basically, this means that the number of electrons per flux quantum has this simple rational fraction form. Okay. Now let's consider a single electron in this geometry, and for the moment assume that there's no potential, no external potential, it's just constant. Then your Hamiltonian simply consists of the usual kinetic energy in the presence of the magnetic field, which indeed involves the magnetic vector potential. So at this point we are implicitly assuming that we can define a magnetic vector potential, and as I say, that requires that N sub S is integral. Okay, now we can define a magnetic translation group in the following way. Let's define these operators, kx and ky, which are given by, this will be the standard expression for the x component of canonical momentum, but you've added this extra term here. Now, what is interesting is that once we've done these operators, it's very easy to show that each of these operators, kx and ky, commute with the Hamiltonian. However, they fail to commute with one another. Okay. Now that is that's an interesting point, because the moment that we have this situation, we have two operators, each of which commutes with the Hamiltonian, but which fail to commute with one another, and it's very trivial to show that our ground state must be at least twofold degenerate. Did I go through this argument before? I don't remember whether I did or not. I don't think so. But the argument is extremely trivial. But basically, you cannot have two operators which fail to commute in a one-dimensional space. So, since they both commute with a Hamiltonian, that means they've both got to be diagonal within the ground state space. Let's now define a magnetic translation operator, which simply exponentiates this this beast here. And from the commutation relations, then we have this relation here. In other words, magnetic translations don't commute except for this special case here, and that will be important later. For this special case, they do commute, otherwise not. Now we have to be a little careful about the boundary conditions here. And when new, assume that the boundary conditions are that if we actually perform a magnetic translation, not a simple translation, but a magnetic translation on psi to get, as it were, to the opposite side of your plate, then you come out with the same value. That's not quite the same as the standard boundary condition which we tend to impose. However, it's almost certainly okay for the case of integral NS, because under that condition, you can simply perform a gauge transformation of this form. It turns out that this gauge transformation is single-valued, and then the transformed wave function does indeed satisfy the usual boundary conditions. So it's just a matter of which gauge you choose to work in, and when you choose to work in this particular one. So I don't think that's difficult. No. You've got a fixed magnetic field. But let's go back for a moment. You're simply defining these operators in this way and then exponentiating them.
So that's just the definition.
That's right. That's just the definition. And if you didn't have any magnetic field, of course, this would just be the standard translation. K would just be essentially the momentum operator. Yeah. Okay. Oh dear, sorry, I seem to have done something stupid. Help. Sorry, can you just get this back up again? Sorry, I pressed the wrong button and everything seems to have disappeared. Okay, thank you. Yeah, good, thank you. Great. Okay, now let's consider the many-body case. And remember, we haven't said whether or not our electrons are interacting, and let them be interacting, for example, by the Coulomb interaction. But it doesn't actually matter, provided this interaction is something physically sensible. Let's define now a total magnetic translation operator, which is just given by this expression here. So again, this is a generalization of what one do in the non-magnetic case. This is just a Q, in that case, would just be the total momentum operator of the system. What you're doing then is to shift each electron through A, but also multiply by this the appropriate phase factor, which is not trivial in this case. Now, first of all, it's fairly obvious that since all I'm doing is to shift each electron by the same amount and multiply by a phase factor, it's fairly obvious that this cannot affect the value of the interaction energy. So what about its effect on the kinetic energy? Well, let's consider the two special cases. We could actually do it more generally, but let's consider the two special cases which are given by this relation here, T1, and is given by this expression here, T2 by this expression here. So in other words, the translation we're considering is through L1 along this actually probably should have a hat on it, I guess. L1 along the x-axis divided by n sub x. This over here. Now, crucial point to notice at this point, the actual magnitude of the translation here, because of this factor of n of s in the denominator, the magnitude of the translation is the order of the magnetic length squared divided by the dimension of the sample. Now remember that we're in the thermodynamic limit, so the magnetic length is essentially infinitesimal with respect to the actual size of the sample. So then this quantity here is very much less than the magnetic length, or indeed any other reasonable microscopic length of the system. It's a very, very tiny distance here. Now, T1 and T2 can be shown. I mean, we've already shown that T1 commutes with the kinetic energy. We've argued that it commutes with the kinetic potential energy. So both of these commute with H. They also leave the boundary conditions invariant. That's a slightly tricky point, but it is true because in this particular case, this expression is just 2 pi. And so the boundary conditions do come out to be left invariant, so you have to work through that to check it. So that means that you can choose the ground state, you choose your representation in the ground state to make the ground state wave functions eigenstates of, say, T2. Well, since T2 is unitary, we have this. We must have this result that, acting on one of the ground state wave functions, it gives this result here. However, T1 and T2, as we've already seen, don't commute. In fact, from the this is the earlier commutation relation and the definitions of T1 and T2, you find this relation here, which, when worked out in detail, says that T1 followed by T2 is T2 followed by T1 multiplied by this exponential factor here. And remember that in general, this factor nu, P over Q, that's the number of electrons relative to the number of flux quanta, that is not in general equal to 1. In fact, for the interesting case, it's not equal to 1. So this commutation relation is non-trivial. So let's consider the states generated by repeated applications of T1 to the ground state wave function, to a particular ground state wave function, say. Since T1 commutes with H, these have to be degenerate of size 0. So I should have said more clearly. Perhaps I'll just go back for a moment. Let's consider a particular ground state, a particular one of the ground states. We've already really determined there must be more than one. Let's consider a particular one of the ground states, which is an eigenstate of T2 and has the eigenvalue lambda. Yeah. Right. Now we're going to operate on that with T1, iterated the operation of T1 on that. By doing so, we must get to other states in the ground state manifold. On the other hand, in view of this equation here, this commutation relation, these are now going to be eigenfunctions of T2 with eigenvalues exponential I times that, and that's not equal to exponential I lambda, except when n is equal to Q. So that then says, for this argument, one concludes that the ground state has to be at least Q-fold degenerate. And that's the case on a torus. Now, it turns out that, of course, a torus is a particular topology. You can consider other topologies. Are people familiar with the meaning of the word surface of genus G? Shall I explain that? Crudely speaking, it means essentially the number of holes that the system has. For example, a sphere has G equal to zero. A torus has G equal to one. A pretzel in the usual shape would have G equals two, et cetera, et cetera. But let's just stick to the torus for simplicity. Okay, now notice that in this, in the whole of this argument, I have not mentioned the fractional quantum Hall effect. In other words, I have not said anything about what I believe the actual nature of the ground state wave function to be. This is the beauty of the argument. You've got out this result, the ground state must be at least Q-fold degenerate, without knowing anything about the nature of the ground state wave function. We see at first sight magic, but nevertheless, it comes out. It's the only consideration you've used is that it's simply that you have a ratio of the number of electrons to the number of flux quanta, which is given by this simple rational fraction. So it's, you look puzzled. Well, actually, it's rather the opposite. Let's just take the very simple case where p equals 1. So p equals 1, q equals 3, sorry, right? So that means you have one electron for every three flux quanta. I think that's the wrong way around. Let's just go back and check. Maybe there's a typo on the. Okay. Yeah. So far at least, then, need not even use the words fractional quantum Hall effect in the title. It's just a theorem about a particular ratio of a particular filling fraction, if you like. Okay, so far, so good. However, if any of this is going to have anything to do with topological protection, we're still going to have to show that all local operators are proportional to the unit operator in the ground state manifold with exponentially small corrections. This proof is not entirely trivial. Again, it's given by Wen and Yu in their paper. It goes. You may not be able to follow it at the speed we're going at, but hopefully you'll be able to go back and look at it when this is posted. Let's consider a general quantity, a general one-body quantity of the following form. It's a sum of I, U of Ri, that can be Fourier transformed in the standard way. However, because of the periodicity, the only allowed values of K are these ones here, standard periodic boundary conditions. Incidentally, K here is now, I probably should have used a slightly different notation. It's just a standard vector in momentum space. It's not an operator. Now, we want to evaluate this quantity here with n and n prime states which are in the ground state manifold. From the commutation relations, we have these two relations here. Since T1 to the Qth is 1, and T2 to the Qth is 1 in the ground state manifold, that gives the fact that this quantity is 0. So the matrix element then is 0 unless N1 is equal to L1 times ns over q, and n2 is another integer times ns over q. And therefore, since these are the only non-zero matrix elements, you can expand U in this way. And so it has these k's in its Fourier transform. Therefore, if U is smooth on the scale of our very tiny translation, then the only term which survives is the one with L1 equals to L2 equal to zero. But that's just the integral of U over dr, which is just a C number. So that's proportional one within the ground state manifold. Okay? So this then says that because of this very tiny translation which we needed to get from one ground state to the next, where remember we're shifting all the electrons through this very, very tiny distance, because it's so tiny, it will not be sensitive to any fluctuations of the external potentials, which are over a reasonable scale. Okay. A couple of comments on this. First of all, as we already commented, the whole argument of when and new does assume that ns equals an integer, and the reason for that is that it isn't, then we can't really get off the ground because we can't define the vector potential consistently on our torus. As I say, I emphasize again, this is not a physical, a physically reasonable model. It is a toy model for conceptual purposes. Now, if we're going to seriously envisage this as a model of topological protection, we still need to worry about higher order effects. It is the effects of transitions out of the ground state manifold into excited states. That then requires an energy gap separating the ground state from the excited state. And this, as far as I can see, is really the only point at which when and new would ever need to invoke the fractional quantum Hall effect. It is indeed known, and we'll come to this in the next lecture, it is known that we do indeed have a gap in the between the ground state and excited states in the fractional quantum Hall effect. However, it's not obvious to me that you couldn't have other kinds of ground state where you equally got a gap, which had nothing to do with the fractional quantum Hall. So again, I think the argument of when and new is actually more general than they advertise it. Okay, so I think it's a very, very neat model. You will need to go through a certain amount of algebra just to confirm that this does work, but I think you can take it that it does. It does rather clearly indicate that you have these degenerate ground states which need in some sense I think it's sort of intuitively obvious that it needs a rather sophisticated operation to connect them. You've got to be able to move all your electrons together through this very tiny distance. Okay, any questions or comments on that before I go on to the second example? Okay, actually, I don't think I'm now going to probably get completely finished, but let's try to go on. Taking too much time talking about other interesting things. Okay, let's go on to our second example, the toric code. Now, how many people have actually worked through Kitaev's paper in detail on this? Okay, well, you can tell me if you think I'm doing something something wrong. It's quite easy to get things confused, I find, in this. But again, it's a very neat. This is an example which was published by Kitaev a few years ago. I think it was actually composed way back, but it was only published in 2003. And again, it's very neat because you can actually, at least in principle, work out everything in fine detail for the last stage. So this again, this is different. This involves an n plus n lattice now, but this is actually a lattice of points here with periodic boundary conditions. The interesting objects here are not the points themselves, but the links of the lattice. And the links, each link of the lattice is supposed to be associated with a qubit, that is with a spin sigma I. And if you count it, that means you have two n squared spins in total. So as I say, forget about the points. It's the links which are important in this argument. Now, notice for future reference that the sigmas on different links commute, but the on a given link, that is a given link I, the different components, alpha and beta, these alpha and beta are different Cartesian components, they of course anticommute in the standard way. And that means in turn that if I now take, I don't know if you can see this, sigma I alpha, sigma j alpha, commuted with sigma I beta, sigma j beta, that commutator is, the commutator now is zero. Okay, so that'll be quite important. Okay, let's consider the Hamiltonian, Hamiltonian given by this expression here. A here is the following. You take a given site, S here, and you take the product of the x components of spin on the links surrounding it. Sorry, these, again, typo uncorrected. The j should be actually a subscript here, in fact, and here. So A is the product of the spins on the links surrounding a given point. B, the quantity BP, is given by choosing a particular point in the middle of a block, here that's P, and considering the links which surround it, and taking the product of the Z components of spin. And it's fairly obvious that because of these, the Pauli spin matrices, of course, have eigenvalue 1, then the eigenvalues of both AS and BP must be plus or minus 1. Obviously, the different A's commute with one another, the different B's commute with one another. Less trivially, since AS and BP either have no link in common or two links in common, then because of this commutation relation, the AS, all AS must commute with all BP. So we can now choose, we've got here's a Hamiltonian, we can choose our ground state to be a common eigenfunction of all the AS's and all the BP's with eigenvalue plus 1 because of the minus sign in here. And that the energy of that ground state would be minus 2n. Now, since the product of all the AS's has to be plus 1 and the product of all the BP's has to be plus 1, you can easily verify that by multiplying them out, then the excited states require at least 2 of the A's or 2 of the B's to be minus 1. So you can't just have 1. You can't just change 1 of the A's to be minus 1 or you'd violate this condition here. That means that the minimum excitation energy must be 4 in this case. We're of course working in dimensionless units, so that's 4. Okay, so far? Now the interesting point is that in fact the ground state is fourfold degenerate. How are we going to see that? Well, a simple argument is that the total Hilbert space is 2 to the 2 n squared dimensional. But because of the constraints that the product of the A's and the product of the B's must both be 1, that means that there are only, I think should be 2n squared minus 2, sorry, not 2 raised to the n, but n squared, 2n squared minus 2 independent A's and B's, and, that is right, 2 to the 2n squared minus 2, I think. Therefore, you get this number of conditions, and therefore the dimensionality of the ground state between these two, which is 4. So, it's a bit of algebra we have to just do there to make sure the effects of n are right, but that's what comes out. A slightly more physical way of seeing this is: suppose we work in the standard basis, which is the basis of eigenstates of sigma z, and we associate with sigma I z equals plus or minus 1. A quantity zi, which is either 0 or 1. So it's just another representation. Then the constraint, b sub p, is equal to 0, is equivalent to the statement, well, the sum of the zj's going around the p in question is 0 modulo z. Imagine, this should be, okay, I'm sorry, again, I think a typo here. The constraint b sub p equals 1 should be that, and if it's minus 1, this would be 1. Now let's imagine we combine two neighbouring blocks in the following way. Then you see that because these two links the contribution of these two links cancels out. Then you have B C prime, that's this large contour here, is the sum of these two minus two twice Z2, but Z2, 2 Z2 is zero modulo 2. So if you so this comes out to be zero. So if you iterate this procedure, then you get you find that the value of BP given around these four is zero. However, you have periodic boundary conditions here, so you can satisfy this constraint. The constraint that around this whole contour B subtotal is zero, and satisfy that in one either of four ways. V1 here can be either zero or one. V2, that's the value along this edge, can be zero or one. The value along this edge can be zero or one. So that gives you four possibilities, four independent states, as indeed you found here. So we recap then that the ground state manifold is fourfold degenerate, and the states then may be labeled by these topological quantum numbers, which basically tell you about the states of the spins along these edges here. And it turns out that you can actually count these, not necessarily by just having a contour along the edge. You can displace it any way you like. However, it is essential that the contours you're talking about go around the torus. The ones that loop around the torus. Well, because any contours which don't loop around the torus, like this one here, can always be contracted so that the sum of the z's around the is zero. You simply break this up into its into the individual packets here. I agree, it's not obvious perhaps immediately. Well, I mean, no, I'm not saying it's not interesting, but the special contours, the ones that in some sense measure the values of V1 and V2, are ones which completely loop around the torus. Have to go right across it. There. Yeah, I mean, I agree. Yeah, no, I agree. I mean, many of these things really, really aren't very intuitive at first sight. Yes. Yeah. Okay, well, I think we're coming on to the point you mentioned. Yeah. So what operators connect the degenerate states in the ground state manifold? Well, let's consider operators of the following form. Let's call them strings. They're products of the sigma z is a product of sigma zi along a particular contour here, c. So probably I should really write a z of c here. It's a particular, I'm talking about a particular contour. Similarly, x is given by this expression here, which involves sigma z, sigma j x. If a z-loop is contractible, like, say, this one here, then it can be written in the form of a product over the BPs, and therefore is one within the ground state manifold. That's basically the point we're just talking about. If an x-loop is contractible, again, it can be written as a product of A's. Again, it's plus one in the ground state manifold. Now, of course, the interesting question is, what about if the loop is not contractible? That is, it loops once around the torus, like this or like this. So, now at this point, I have to admit that there's a I should have really put a lot more detail, I think, in the argument at this point. So, let's just think about it a little. We're going to be considering a particular form of z where it actually goes right across the torus here. Because I can shift it up to this, towards the edge here, that basically is counting for me the, now we have to be careful here about our notation. It's going to be counting V2 here. So it, but it just counts, it still leaves you in the same state. However, what about X1? Suppose that X1 is going up here. Well, remember we're in the basis, in basically the Z basis, not the X basis. So when X is crossing the boundary, this is a difficult bit, I think, which does need a certain amount of thinking about. When the X string crosses this boundary here, that's the boundary in the, let's see, was it one direction or the two direction? We have to get our notation straight here, I guess. Let's say this is in the two direction. When it crosses the boundary in the two direction, then it's going to flip a spin on this boundary, and therefore it's going to change the value of the one along, that is the sum of the z's along here. Remember, sigma x anticommutes with sigma z, and that's the, what we're using here. So that then means that x2 anticommutes with z1, and similarly, by a similar argument, x1 anticommutes with z2. So what does this mean? Z1 and z2 certainly commute with one another, x1 and x2 commute with one another, etc. So what that means is that the structure of the operators here is identical to that of a two-qubit space, where, however, you have to be very careful about the identification. Z1 goes over into SZ1, but Z2 goes over into SX2, etc. So if I've done this right, you'll find that the commutation relations are indeed isomorphic. So in other words, we've got ourselves basically all the operations of a two-qubit system. Now, okay, very quickly, this is not particularly important, but it turns out that you can actually construct the states of the ground state manifold in the standard basis. This is done by Kitaev in his paper. I'll just basically flip straight to the result. It turns out that in the Z basis, the actual explicit form of the eigenstates is simply a symmetric superposition of all possible states which satisfy these two boundary conditions. Now you remember that these two conditions are different for the four states of your subspace. So the states which are involved here are in fact different for each of these four, but given that, you've got an equal superposition of all of them. So we're not actually going to need that point, in fact, later, but that's what comes out. Okay, here's a more important point. Let's consider the matrix elements of local operators. Let's consider an arbitrary operator of the following form, where it's a product of some spins. Basically, since we're working with this 2n squared qubit system, then the only operators which are relevant are the Pauli spin matrices. It's an arbitrary product, but here we do have the condition that the various IJKs denote nearby links, not necessarily nearest neighbor, but nearby. Now we can displace the contours C1, C2, etc., arbitrarily, as long as they wrap around the torus. And so it's clear that we can choose these. So this operator omega commutes with all of these operators, Z1, Z2, X1, and X2. In other words, in our qubit language, omega commutes with the sigmas. But in a qubit, two-dimensional Hilbert space, any operator which commutes with both sigma X and sigma Z must be a constant times the unit operator. And therefore, in the ground state manifold, which is composed of two qubits, this local operator must be equal to one. And any effect then, as it were, any effect by which this operator mixes the different states of the ground state, That must come indirectly through transitions out of the ground state manifold. However, the perturbation needs to change of the order of n spins. And so, by the argument I gave earlier, the effect should be exponentially suppressed with n here, the total number of links in one direction. This is a very typical result for topological protection. The indirect matrix elements always exponentially suppressed in this way.
So is there some sense in which basically if you apply some, if there's some local error or sort of fluctuation, you know, you just sort of shift your line and just let it just sort of go around?
Critically speaking, yes. You to get, as it were, to get from one of these ground states to another, you have to apply this the Z1 operators are going up a particular contour, but that contour can be shifted off to as far as you want it. Yep.
Right. So you have to start an operation which spans the entire...
Absolutely, yes. Yes, it's got to, in some sense, involve going around the torus. Okay, sorry, let me just go back for a moment. Are there any questions on that? I realise, again, it's not easy to intuit what's going on here without sitting down and doing a certain amount of algebra. Yep.
Does that correspond to our physical operation?
Oh, well, right. Okay. Yes. Well, that's a. Indeed, that's a very important question. In order to go from one of these ground states to another, we've got to change of the order of n spins, which involves this, and moreover, we've got to do it in a particular way, which involves this, that we're going around the torus. Now, we'll see. If I get to the end of this lecture, we'll see that. This one way of representing what we have to do is to create a couple of anion-like excitations, braid them around one another, and then annihilate them again. So that's what, hopefully, nature can't do, or is not going to do with any principle of probability. Okay, so let me go on. I'm going to have to, speed up to get through this. Let me try, at least. I suspect, in any case, much of this may be somewhat familiar to you. Anions are, by definition, are quasi-particles moving in two dimensions with non-standard exchange statistics. First proposed by Linus and Mirheim in this very beautiful paper in 1977, rediscovered and named as anions by Wilczek a few years later. Just a reminder, for two particles, encirclement of one by the other is simply equivalent to a double exchange plus possibly a linear shift, which is irrelevant to the statistics. Secondly, in three dimensions, a 360-degree encirclement can always be reduced to the identity without the particles ever having to coincide. If I had the appropriate object, I could probably demonstrate this. But, however, if I'm confined to two dimensions, that's no longer the case. So in three dimensions, because of this, forget about this, this is just a side comment. So because of this, in three dimensions, the operation of interchanging two identical particles can only have the eigenvalues plus or minus one. Therefore, and plus one for bosons, minus one for fermions, obviously. In two dimensions, that argument doesn't work. Or equivalently, braiding is not equal to permutation. In two dimensions, braiding may have a sense. That is, this operation is not necessarily equivalent to this operation. So in other words, in two dimensions, it is not excluded that for certain kinds of quasi-particles, clockwise exchange should give an eigenvalue exponential I phi, where phi is not necessarily equal to pi or 2 pi. If this is all, as it were, then what you're talking about, by definition, is a billion anions. And that's what we're going to talk about for the rest of this lecture. Now, how do you produce anions in real life? I think because I'm running late, I will essentially skip this view graph. But crudely speaking, the answer is that although the eigenvalues of the total charge density within a particular region, particularly precisely defined region of space, the eigenvalues of the total charge in there have to be integral. No, that's a basic principle of quantum field theory. Right? However, that does not mean that if you take either a classical average or a quantum mechanical average here, that expression has to be integral. And indeed, in many cases, it's not. Let me skip the simple example here and just go on. Second thing I trust most of you are very familiar with. So you have. Okay. Sorry, I know this is going rather fast. Yeah. Okay. I trust most of you are fairly familiar with Berry's phase. So perhaps again, I can go through this rather quickly. This is if you vary your Hamiltonian in a way depending on a particular external parameter lambda, and you carry your system around a loop so that lambda comes back to its original value, then you'll find that in general, apart from the usual usual dynamical phase, which depends on the details of the trajectory, you always you in general pick up a geometrical or so-called Berry phase here, which is given by this expression here. And the standard example of that is a spin a half particle in a magnetic field which is allowed to rotate in direction slowly as a function of time and return to itself. If it does that, then it turns out that you come back to yourself with a Berry phase, which is given by this expression here. And incidentally, a special case of this is if you make your magnetic field lie actually normal to the z-axis and rotate it around like so, then that's equivalent to rotating the spin through 2 pi. And as you know, for fermions, the particles are spin a half. That gives you a factor of -1, not +1. And that's actually seen in, for example, neutron interferometry experiments. So very fast again. Okay, I think I'll just skip this one. There's extra notes on the Berry phase. But let's just put together the results of the former considerations. Let's imagine a quantum particle which can be localized either at O or at R, and it's in orbit in a superposition of the two states. Now imagine a second particle, B, which is constrained to be in a p-state relative to A. In other words, the relative wave function has this form. Forget about the radial dependence, it just has the form exponential I phi. Phi is the angle of RB relative to RA. Then the general wave function would be of the following superposition form, entanglement, if you like, between the two. And of course, that wave function is perfectly single-valued with respect to R sub B. Now imagine that you, as it were, somehow pin R sub B with a stray external potential and move it adiabatically around O. On a timescale long compared to the matrix element for this guy to move backwards and forwards. The question is, what's the phase change? We can parameterize the dashed path here by the angle phi. So d psi by d lambda is now given by this expression here. Because psi 0 and psi r, the two different states of the heavy particle, as it were, they're assumed orthogonal or normalized, then this term does not contribute, and the only contribution to this is given by this expression. There's no cross term, and you get this expression for the Berry phase. The Berry phase, then, is given by this expression here, 2 pi a squared plus b squared delta phi r. In other words, it's crudely speaking, you've gone round this, you've got around the origin once, thereby picked up a factor of 2 pi. That's weighted by the amount of time that your heavy particle actually spent in this state here. On the other hand, it also spends some time here, but now the point is that you have not actually gone through 2 pi with respect to the angle here. As you go around here, the angle with respect to the 2 r is just going backwards and forwards, it's not going through 2 pi. So that means that the answer to your Berry phase is given by 2 pi times the amplitude squared, or the probability for your heavy particle, the red guy, to be in this state rather than this state. In other words, the statistical phase is 2 pi times the fractional mean charge enclosed by the path. Well, you look puzzled. I'm not surprised, but...
Yeah,
sorry. So, Yeah, sorry, I shouldn't really use the phrase charge at this point, I guess. It's actually the probability, the time average probability that the heavy particle, the red guy, spends its time here rather than here. And this is non-integral, and that's how you get the non-integral phase. So this is just a rather hand-waving argument of a kind we'll meet in a somewhat more respectable form in the case of Laplacian quasi-particles in the quantum fraction quantum Hall effect. So very briefly, I would like to just make sure I just finish this bit, because I think it is quite interesting. Let's go back to the toric code for a moment. Let's start with the system in the four-fold degenerate ground state manifold and create strings. Again, I've changed my notation slightly here. Formerly these were z sub c of t, I guess. So t here is meant to indicate the contour on which I create these spins. Now, these commute with all the A's and B's, except for the endpoint ones where they invert the sign. So since they invert the sign of two endpoint A's or B's, the energy cost is 4 for each of the kind of string. Now, in fact, once the endpoints are fixed, it doesn't matter how we lay the string, provided we don't wrap it around the torus or cross another string. So it's only the endpoints then which are physically significant, and they then can be regarded as independent quasi-particles. Now this is a special case of a much more general situation we're going to come to in the non-abelian context, that in some sense the quasi-particles we're going to be talking about throughout the whole discussion of topological quantum computing are in some sense not real. They're made by artificially breaking up certain kinds of operation which you can do on the ground state manifold or similar things. So it's clear that moving one x quasar particle around another x quasar particle or a z around a z has no effect. Also, if you move a pair of x's around a pair of z's, that has no effect. But the interesting question is, what about moving a single x quasar particle around a single z quasar particle? Well, that's equivalent to crossing a Z string with an X string. That then will, this is basically a generalization of the argument I used earlier, that will result in a single link J being operated on with both sigma XJ and sigma ZJ. If these two have no link in common, then they commute. If they do have one link in common, then they anticommute. And therefore, going through a little bit of algebra you have to go through here, if you start off with this configuration with z, here are your two z anions here and here. Here is your x anions here and here. You can take one of your x anions, wrap it around here. So that means your x quasar particle circulated, encircled your z quasar particle once. And by this little bit of algebra, that actually changes the sign of the total wave function. In other words, the x and the z, this should actually be, I think, relative semions. I think there's a typo here. This is semions. If I encircle an x quasar particle with a z quasar particle or vice versa, you get minus 1. So that means, since exchange is the square root of encirclement, that means that exchange gives exponential I pi over 2. Okay. Now, finally, what's the connection between the topologically protected ground states and the anions? Let's take the toric code as an example. We showed when looking at the degeneracy of the ground state manifold and the operators we needed to move between us, we showed that z1 and x2 anticommute. In other words, we get this result here. Now, we can think of this in words as z1 creates a pair of anions at 0, takes one of them right across the torus in dimension 1 back to a 0, and annihilates back into the ground state. Similarly for x2, create a quasar particle here, take it across, and annihilate back into the ground state. However, you don't actually need to do this. You don't actually need to torus. You can do the following. Start with z1 here, put x2 across it. Z to the minus 1 is then this operation here, and x2 to the minus 1 brings us back here. But you see now, you can now put these ends together, as it were. And this is simply equivalent to taking a z anion around an x anion, which gives you precisely a phase of pi as we already found. So there is a strong connection between the fractional statistics obeyed by the anions and the nature of the operations needed to go between the topologically protected ground states. Okay, I realise that's been very fast because I did want to make sure I did get through it in this lecture. But as I say, you probably, I think you'll find you will benefit by going through the algebra at your own pace and so forth, and seeing that these results do in fact come out. Any general comments, questions? Right. Yes.
How is this picture?
Yes. Well. Okay. I think we cheated in a way. When we started with the ground state, we created a single loop, say of z operations and so forth, and then noted that we could shrink it down without anything happening. Now we've already done the other way around, but here effectively. We've created an X excitation before we created the Z one. So we're not starting, as it were, from the same point in the two cases. So if we've got no X excitations there at all, then any Zs which don't go around the torus can be shrunk down and just give you something trivial. If you do have some X excitations there, the question is, are you or are you not crossing an X string during this process? If you are, then you have to worry. Then that's when you get the non-trivial results. Sorry. It's not too obvious, I think, at first sight. Okay, so let's stop at this point. And I'm going to spend the next lecture discussing something which perhaps is not centrally related to topological quantum computing, but is a necessary, as it were, platform. And that is the standard fractional quantum Hall effect, Laughlin quasar particles and all that. This involves only abelian anions, but it is, I think, a necessary platform for the later discussion of non-abelian anions in the quantum Hall effect.